code.
Okay, so we are not, my intention was not to go in any of the technical topics in depth, but if you have any questions, feel free to stop, we can definitely discuss. Okay, so first I would like to give a quick, very short overview of what we are trying to do in VMware SaaS. So it's a multi-cloud management solution. It combines a lot of capabilities like your application deployment, monitoring, management, how do you find costing, allocation, so on and so forth. So when we are starting this, we started this as like SaaS first. It's like a platform, not we are building a product. So it's a platform for whole VMware and not a single product. It enables like DevOps, developers to be more agile, and there are a lot of customers who have private clouds, right? So if their load suddenly increases, how they can react? So how they can leverage just for sudden load public cloud and go back to private cloud. So all such things will be taken care using this VMware SaaS platform. So there are so many other things that I can speak about VMware SaaS, but in interest of the topic, skipping those, and we are quickly covering like what are the major tech stacks that we use within the platform. So essentially, all of the services that we have built are all distributed microservices. We have a wide variety of tech stacks. We use stateful applications, stateless applications. We call something like soft state applications that we pretty much fall like Redis use case, whatever we have covered earlier. Okay, so we basically have two types of applications, right? So when we started this initiative, we were building new applications. We call it greenfield. So all those things we tried, we built it using a framework, Xenon framework, which was developed by VMware. It's available in public GitHub, open source. It enables us to give build a distributed application, and all the states are stored in disk, but it's not really required. So for performance reasons, what we will try to do is the state will be stored across multiple machines, multiple pods. So typical I/O issue, right? So if you are writing to a disk, it will be like 10 times slower than you sending the same data to another machine within a network. So the main reason that you do is for performance, and the advantage is that if your node goes down, there is another node who is always having the data, from whom you can get back the data. So these approaches are usually used in like when you want high throughput and network applications, right? And you have other means of recovering the state. And there are existing applications which are typical entire application, entire architecture of applications, right? Like you have database layers, multiple middle tiers, and the front-end tiers. Right. So we containerize all those applications, and we use the notion of Kubernetes pod to give, okay, two middle layers have to be always coexistent. Right? Say, if you're running in a machine, there have to be two services which assumes I can access the other application via localhost. If you want to give the same sense in Kubernetes, you bring up multiple containers within a pod to give the same feeling. So we use those. And as much as possible in existing application, we segregate the stateless applications from stateful applications so that it helps you to easily scale. So most of your business logic will be in stateless applications, and your stateful will be pretty much your data stores and mostly data stores, right? So you can have different scaling policies for stateless versus stateful applications. So if you follow a typical entire architecture, you will probably be putting only database layers in stateful applications and everything else in stateless applications. Okay, so we use Kubernetes deployments kind a lot. So this actually, we wrap most of our business logic and model it as the stateless containers. These usually have Java based and scale up based applications. So We set different scale policies, replica sets. You can define different auto scale policies. All those things can be controlled very easily because Kubernetes deployment is very stable. It's there from like their initial version, and we haven't seen much issues in deployment. Whereas on the contrary, if you use fetch sets or stateful sets, it has quite a bit of issues. It wasn't initially matured in version like 1.3.5, 1.3.6. There are so many disadvantages why you would be probably avoiding stateful sets. Sorry, fetch sets. Now with 1.5.2, stateful set is much, much more matured than fetch set, and we are using that in few places. So the other thing was, as I said, soft state applications. So these are usually network applications who do not try to do an I/O, rather store contents in peers. Right? So they usually follow peer-to-peer topology and gossip protocol to agree to a consensus. So we use Xenon framework to do that. And this is pretty much like an Redis cache kind of use case, right? But we do not use stateful set for this scenario. Rather, we use deployments itself, and in our entry point container, right? So, pod has the ability to trigger your container, right? So we have customized entry point which will block multiple deployments to figure out the IPs of the peers. So basically, why we use stateful sets? Right? Two major reasons. One, predictable namespace. So if you have a stateful set, say size 3. You can definitely predict what will be the name of each of the 3 instances. Like whatever name you have given, -0, -1, -2, that will be required for network applications in order to form your forum. And the next most important reason for you to use stateful set is the actual persistence. Like you have persistent volume, client templates, and you say your database applications, Postgres, Oracle, or Mongo, HBase, all those things will fall into the persistence. So, for these soft state applications, what we want is the predictable name so that we can follow the quorum. So what we do is instead of leveraging the pet set, which was not so stable earlier, we use the deployment. But at the startup, we have logic to pause the container until all the peers have come up and we are able to discover. So it's very similar to what pet set does, right? So you have a headless service. Basically, a headless service is a service name which will not resolve to an IP, but it will resolve to all qualifying IPs. Are you guys familiar with node selection, pod selection in Kubernetes, right? So, yes, no, you want some details? Okay, so quickly, right? How does a Kubernetes service works? So in Kubernetes service, you will tell, okay, figure out all pods which has some labels. I would say key, okay, app is Redis, right? And type is, okay, some XYZ. So whatever pods have come up with those particular labels, all those IPs will be mapped to the service, and you will start having round robin load balancing by default in Kubernetes service. So that's what a typical service does. When we say a headless service or a typical service where you specify cluster IP as none, what happens is for that service, it will not get an IP for that particular FQDN. Rather, it will display all the qualifying pod IPs. So if you do a simple lookup for that name, you will get all qualifying IPs. So for these soft state applications, what we do is on startup, we know our application has to come up with 3 replica sets because we can read Kubernetes config and we can figure out, okay, there has to be 3 nodes. At the startup, we keep on, each container keeps on waiting until the IP. So once I get all the 3 IPs, okay, then I have the IP, I give that to the MongoDB or Xenon so that it can form its own quorum. So that's a kind of approach that we use. And we really found quite a few issues when your process goes out of memory or something gets hung. You will not get notified, right? So it's better to configure liveness for basic health URL so that Kubernetes by default restarts in such scenarios. You can configure Kubernetes to say, okay, check this particular URL at this particular interval, and if that health check fails like 3 times, do a restart. Is it clear? Make sense? Okay, so next is the stateful sets. We use stateful sets for MongoDB, PostgreSQL, and a few other things like HBase and other things. We use mainly whenever we need actual disk storage, right? So MongoDB is, we have containerized the MongoDB and it's set as replicated. Right? So it's replicated. Now, when MongoDB starts, you need to know, you need to initialize the replica set. So you need to tell, here are my peers. And upon that, it will do an automatic election of master. And if your master is going down, unless released, it will automatically quote the next, whichever is healthy and whichever has the latest as the master. So we just have some logic in our container so that we always say, since we are using stateful set here, we can say something like, whichever has coordinate a zero, I will defaultly configure as a master, because that happens when your stateful set comes for the first time or when you are deploying for the first time. After that, you do not have to do it anymore because Mongo is going to manage the leader election by itself. And we use a customized storage class. Right now, we run Kubernetes in AWS. So we have a different storage class, something for specific for MongoDB, something for PostgreSQL, so that you can configure SSD optimized for IOPS in few places, some places, just general purpose SSD. So all those things can be by defining storage class. So stateful set has the volume plane template where you can define, I want XYZ type of storage, and storage class is a separate artifact where you can define XYZ really means general purpose SSD. And in your client template, you can tell, okay, I need 500 gigs of memory or 500 gigs of disk or 800 gigs of disk. So that's how we use for MongoDB. And then for PostgreSQL, we again do streaming replication. But here the challenge comes because Postgres is like active standby, and you will enable the replication, but whoever is going to connect to Postgres needs to know who is the master. So now we have our, say, applications which are going to use Postgres DB. So those applications tries to connect to Postgres DB via a Kubernetes name, Kubernetes service names. So those Kubernetes service names will be mapped to So PG pool is like a Postgres DB connection pool. Its job is to do two main things. First, it keeps on checking whether your master and slave is active. If one of them goes down, in Postgres you have to, replication manager keeps replicating the data, but promoting the slave to master needs to be taken care by Postgres PG pool. And then once that has been promoted, your connections has to be routed to the new master. So what pgpool does is it gives you a different IP to you, whereas your master IP will be IP1, slave will be IP2, whereas pgpool gives you IP10. So you keep on connect, your clients keep on connecting to IP10, and pgpool knows, okay, you should be routing to IP1 or IP2. So basically, whatever MongoDB does internally, we try to simulate the same for PostgreSQL using pgpool. So a few of the things that we follow in our current SaaS offerings are, we try to be cloud agnostic. So if you take, if you have set up Postgres replication, then you would know the amount of challenges it includes. It's very difficult to configure Postgres streaming replication in a container and get automated failover. We go to the pain of doing that instead of, it's very easy to get an replicated instance from AWS. You can go for AWS service. It will be very easy for you to get a Postgres because AWS supports out of the box Postgres with replication. But we don't do that, rather we try to be cloud agnostic. We avoid intentionally all possible AWS services directly using. I think the only place where we be using AWS specific services is Route 53, which is our entry point. And wherever possible, we always prefer stateless. So there are few instances, right? Like soft state applications where we try to avoid stateful application and go to stateless and build some logic so that it provides a lot of advantages in terms of your upgrades. In terms of when you are trying to upgrade Kubernetes cluster itself, you might need to bring a federation cluster for some time, move applications from one cluster to the other cluster. So in all such times, there are good support for deployments, whereas stateful applications are just coming up. It's not so mature yet. And the most important learning that we have is like service discovery. So within cluster, all applications speak to everyone else using Kubernetes service. We started with version 1.3.6, and right now we are in 1.5.2. In all of the versions, we use only QDNS for, we do not use any other network plugins. So we have seen QDNS itself is pretty much stable, and it caters to all our use cases. So within cluster, every application will be able to speak to every other application using the Kubernetes QDNS. So do not use short Kubernetes service name alone. As much as possible, always use the fully qualified name, which will be your service name plus federation cluster name plus your namespace plus your cluster, svc.cluster.token. So always try to use that. And all our HTTP and TCP applications goes via Kubernetes services wherever possible. And external service communication, we have Nginx, a couple of Nginx as the entry point, which is getting routed via Route 53. So all external communication happens only via those entry points. And it's not recommended to enable node port directly on your pods. And Kubernetes networking concepts are so flexible and so powerful, you do not have to worry about port configs anything else. Right? So each pod gets its own IP. So you have like 10 different containers. Each container can say, I listen only to AD, or I listen only to AWS. Because each pods are going to get different IP, you don't have to worry about port configs ever. But if your pod is going to have like three different containers, then all three containers are going to share same ID, which means those containers should have different ports. I think this is very different from Docker networking principle, right? Where you have to explicitly map what is the internal port, what is the external port. You can do that in Kubernetes too, but most of the time it's not required, unless you have specific use cases. Okay, and we have a continuous integration and delivery pipeline using Kubernetes code stream, where each of your feature comes goes to prod. Each commit goes to prod, and you can do all possible testing in the pipeline itself. And we found that's very much required for a SaaS product in order to meet your availability. So VMware SaaS is supposed to be available 99.99 to start with, and our eventual goal is 3. What it means is like per year you can afford 45 minutes of downtime. And it is shared across all the customers of VMware, so maintaining that availability becomes a huge challenge, and Kubernetes helps us a lot. Okay. So the next use case that we are going to highlight is from brownfield. So we have, and we have named it dynamic provisioning, right? But it's not a typical dynamic provisioning. Okay, so the use cases that we had is, right, so there are a few existing applications which can support, say, 5 organizations at a time. But when you are going to SaaS and offering for all customers, you suddenly need to horizontally scale your application. So your application in itself will have Postgres, Mongo, Kafka, HBase, n number of backend stores, n number of middle tiers, right? So your single application itself might require 3 nodes. Now, the moment you see a 6th customer, so say based on your demand, right, you can say, okay, I have 10 customers which can be supported using one deployment of my application. When I see the 11th customer, you have to dynamically provision the same infrastructure again. So Kubernetes will help you to do a Kubernetes construct, right? There's an infrastructure level. You can say deployment, stateful sense, port server, but it's limited to a set of containers. It's not at a big application level. So we have that use case, and we have built in what we call as onboarding service, which manages this complexity. So what it does is, so it runs as a stateless service deployment inside the cluster. It uses JSON templates to create Kubernetes resources. So whatever we have seen, a normal pod, right, it will have everything filled in. But what we use here will be pretty much like a number of variables. Those variables will be dynamically populated when the onboarding service figures out, okay, I'm running out of load, I'm running out of size, I have to provision a new application altogether. So this service is like very lazy in terms of, unless it really requires to provision a brand new n number of pods and stateful sets, it doesn't do. And what also it doesn't do is say one of the organization leaves, right? So will you try to reshuffle? So your application supports 10 tenants. Now you have spinned up. Out of 10, 1% have left. Do you try to optimize it? We don't try to optimize it. Like, you can probably move that customer to the old node and get rid of the new deploy versions to reduce cost, right? We don't try to do it. And it is very helpful to do the updates. Now, imagine how you can do the updates of your application, right? So I have 100 customers and 10 instances of my applications are running. All of them are running in version 5. I need to go to version 6. Now you need to do an incremental upgrade of at application level rather than a usual container level. So those logics we have built in the onboarding service.
One question. So when you're deploying the servers or when you're scaling the servers, how do you handle the HA proxy in Unix? How do you configure the backend?
So there are two things, right? When your application, we use Nginx along with OpenRest, right? Now, whenever an application comes up, application tries to register the fully qualified Kubernetes service name to the Nginx. Okay, so when my application has come up for first 10 tenants, it would say XYZ as an external path, right? So what Nginx basically does is it exposes you URL 1 to the public world and it maps that to IP2 behind the scenes. When it is URL 2, it maps to IP2. When it is URL 3, it maps to IP3. Now, instead of that typical flow, what we do is we register URL 1, but instead of IP1, we give the Kubernetes service name of that restaurant. So our application comes up with three nodes, right? For all the three nodes, I have a single SQDN in Kubernetes, so I register that with Nginx. And Nginx has some issues in terms of binding to an overlay number. So the service name can be resolved only within QPNS, right, within cluster. But when Nginx by default starts, Nginx also starts within Kubernetes, but it will not be able to resolve short names. There is a bug in Nginx and OpenRest, which we have, our team has fixed. Right? So with that, you will be able to register your FQDN, and Nginx will be able to route your FQDN, and then Kubernetes does the routing from that point onwards.
So when you scale it, for example, if your backend has multiple...
So when
you scale it, do you again update?
No. So because the entry that we registered to Kubernetes, the entry that we registered to Nginx is the Kubernetes service name. When I scale, my pod size increases, right? But what Kubernetes does is it speaks to the API server and a new DNS entry got resolved. So how it works is Nginx will send the request to IP1. IP1 is the SQDN of Kubernetes service. Now, when it in the routes, IP route tables, it would have said if it is IP1, it can send to IP 11.12.13. When you have scaled, it will add one more entry saying it can send to 14 also. So from Nginx perspective, it's transparent. Whether you scale up, scale down, no changes are required in Nginx. The only changes required is when you are bringing up a brand new URL. But if we haven't registered the FQDN, then the problem that you said comes up, right? Because whenever you scale up, scale down, you have to move up and move down from
The bug you talked about, is it fixed upstream?
Yeah, in OpenRest module, it's been fixed. But I think initially, ingress component of Kubernetes was not so powerful. If your use cases are simple, which is like you have a couple of web applications that you want to expose to the outside world, then you can simply create Kubernetes ingress itself with Nginx that will do the routing for you. Right?
But it still doesn't do TCP, so that is...
No. So when, so they have written Go code, which actually listens for Kubernetes API change, and they change the Nginx mapping accordingly.
But so the ingress works only for HTTP, it doesn't do TCP. So that is one reason to use Nginx or HAProxy.
No, we use Nginx. I think...
I'm talking about ingress. Ingress doesn't do TCP,
yeah.
But Nginx or HAProxy.
Yes. Good. Our use cases were limited to HTTP from external communication. We do not allow other modes of communication. Even though wherever we use Kafka, we route it. Yeah, we do TCP IP there. But yeah, Kubernetes Ingress doesn't support TCP at the moment. But I think there are there is one other container, just like Nginx and HTTP/proxy, who were trying to do TCP also in Ingress. It's available in that example. And yeah, related to that topic, it's better if you avoid ELB of AWS. If you simply compare the performance of ELB versus Nginx, you would see Nginx like performing 25 to 100 times better than ELB. Right. So this dynamic provisioning, right? So this control plane is built using Xenon, and we have created a Kubernetes REST spec in Java. Because this logic is written in Java, we want to directly create Kubernetes resources. It's not a YAML that you can upload via kubectl, right? So we have created a REST spec client in Java, and we have a separate layer where we build business logic to say when I should scale up, when I should do scale up. We don't do scale up. We just create few alerts saying, okay, there are resource under utilization. And most of the challenges that we have seen is with respect to Kubernetes version upgrade. When we initially built this, we were using Kubernetes 1.3.5, right? And suddenly, so at that time, stateful set, pet set was alpha. They suddenly moved to 1.4.7. In 1.5.2, in 1.5 onwards, it became stateful set. So those kind of, that brings a huge challenge when you are dynamically provisioning. Right, and environment abstraction is very key because, say, if I am spinning up a Mongo in production, right, I will probably use 1 TB of files. Whereas if you're doing it in dev, you will probably use like 10 gig, right? So you need to create appropriate environment abstractions, and where you use Kubernetes config map, where you use Kubernetes secret, you have to be quite careful. So as much as possible, we use Kubernetes secret for all passwords that we want to share. Because if you see, when we are dynamically creating a Postgres DB, we have to pass that username password to the next application, which I am going to create. So we automatically generate a username password. We have an init container, which is initialization Postgres with appropriate schemas, right? And then those username password, we put it in a Kubernetes secret in a different file. And we pass that to the next coming container. We mount that in a path so that they can read the username password from just like a property file and use it forward. Any questions so far?
So for certificates, you use secrets or certificates are built in the image?
Okay, so for now, within internal cluster, we don't use certificates. We have a concept of certification board, which we pretty much want to put in secrets, basically mounted directories, which is shared across all, right? So the certification board has more responsibility. When your board comes up, it has to copy a few certificates, or you want to put a global secret and like expose it every day. Each service might need its own certificate. So it's quite intensive. For now, our certificates ends at the entry point itself. So Nginx converts the HTTPS to HTTP and pass it internally.
Are you using any sharded-based application?
We use Mongo.
So how do you manage while scaling down the sharded application using stateful set?
Okay, so actually we do not support downgrade of Mongo at the moment. There are quite a few challenges. Now, what we are trying to do is, okay, so there is one other application that we have, like Xenon, which is also, it does not provide internal sharding. You have to do external sharding. It's all HTTP based. So what we try to do is, yeah, we try to do sharding in our application logic rather than going and doing inside. So it's, we try to access everything via HTTP. Since it's HTTP, you can embed the sharding logic in your URI bar. It's as simple as saying instance one hyphen instance two. Instead of the, so because stateful set is not a so mission, right? So we found it risky to use it.
So do you think that a cleanup facility in stateful set would make it more meaningful?
I definitely do, but I see quite a few challenges in terms of how and when it can be invoked. So there are so many instances where your node goes down abruptly, right? How can Kubernetes